digging around in a worm tub, and where I released them, there I haven't found a single one. And there's none underneath the burdock and none underneath the lucerne. So I covered it up, kind of just, oh, there's another worm here. But they're right on the edges here. You see, I found some here. And this is where I buried a bunch of skirt leaves. So they're here. Oh, there's another one. Quite a ways away from where I released them. Black raspberry cane that sent out a lot of shoots, and I think it was in response to being ate down by a rabbit the year before. And a lot of these shoots came down and rooted, tip rooted. And this one's actually kind of layered itself. Here, it's got a root right here where something's coming out. There's a root here. There's a root here right at the end of it. Nice plant coming out. There's a whole bunch of them all in a circle all the way around that have rooted like this. And I want to document all of the blossoms, all the laterals that it sent out of each one of these shoots. I suppose there's a lot of nutrients flowing both ways. That's the genesis right there. Oh, there's a little pawpaw sucker in here too. That's good. That's the genesis right here. You can see the old canes from last year. Oh, you can see them where they were ate by the rabbits. See that? The rabbit ate the old canes here. And then all these bluish canes, these are the ones that grew last year in response. And now we're setting up brand new shoots from this year. These are biennials. Ooh, I like that. That's really luscious. This pawpaw actually died. Ooh, and a third one. Ooh, I got lots of them to go up north with. Unless these are from seeds, because we had pawpaws all over the place back here. But this pawpaw died. That's probably what it is. Because it died, it's sending out all these suckers. Oh, we got thimbleberry takeoff. I haven't grown very many thimbleberries. Just a handful last year. Thimbleberries. The persimmon service tree race is still ongoing. Right now it's a service tree that's a teeny bit ahead. On the trees that I've planted in my backyard, there are lots of these pawpaws forming. I'm gonna order a bunch of pots and start them as seedlings. Maybe I can sell a few. The promise of mulberries. This tree produces so many mulberries that it can feed the birds and me. He's here for the black walnuts. They're doing a good job cleaning them up. So here's an idea. When I'm having crops that they like to eat, say for instance the apricots, and they ripen a little bit earlier so they're all by themselves, I dump out some of these black walnuts. And they're gonna go after these instead of the apricots. So you see where something's been digging, wanting to get in. I don't know if it's a mouse. Mouse can jump over the top and get through chicken wire, or if it's a woodchuck. Testing, where's the weakness? This pawpaw machine is loaded. An old tree. Look at that, how many is it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And the whole tree's got them just loaded. And it's even supporting a male kiwi. Double duty. quadruple duty with all these fruits on it. Hopefully some drop off. The black walnut husks have iodine, and these squirrels are cleaning them all over the yard. They're fertilizing the yard for me, for free. Peach. Grafted to plum. Seeds of the wild leek. Ramps. So here's the leaves dying back. And now they're gonna make their seed. Ooh, getting our mercenary here. Some little baby stinging nettles coming up here. Not sure what that is. Might be a ribe. That is definitely a ribe right there. Yeah, self-seeded peach right here. Let it go. There's a lot of ramps in here making seed. Here's a, I think this is a hazelnut from seed. Must be a plum that suckered over here. I'll probably dig that out and bring it up north. I watered most of the garden beds with ferment this morning, and now I'm a walking nose wrinkler. There he is. Black squirrel. A mulberry graft. Doesn't look the healthiest, but it's working. And it's gonna show what kind of mulberries it's growing. It's gonna grow. A little sample. Nice leaves. Now these are older pollards. You can see the heads are well formed, and look. We have takeoff. We have a linden that wants to go. Look at it, I think it's producing flowers right there. That's quite interesting. This is the pawpaw tree that I topped to find out what it would do. Last year didn't have many fruits. But this year it's going to have fruits. And 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 it's going to have fruits. Nuts with fruits. Oh, that's an iconic one. Picture right there in the middle over here. Pawpaws and symmetry. Almond mushroom spawn has arrived in the mail. And I went over the directions a second time. Make sure I'm gonna apply this the right way. The direction says 6 to 8 inches of compost. I think we're gonna be easy that right here. Now there's enough supposedly to do a 4x4 foot area, so I have to find one more spot. The compost making deal is kind of wearing thin for me. Lost its appeal. So maybe this will reignite it. I'm going to be planting these mushroom spores in this compost that I made. And hopefully have a good reason to make another one next year. Once you open it, you gotta plant it, is what the instructions said, so I'm committed. There were like 3 or 4 different instructions. One says leave it sit for 6 to 8 weeks to make sure it's good. The other one says open it right away and plant it. Plant them 4 to 6, 6 to 8 inches apart. Dig them in. Plant.
too.
All right, rake those two areas clean. Now, some of the mushroom instructions said it should be contacted with the soil, but it didn't say that for the almonds. I'm just going to make sure and go ahead and get some soil contact with the compost. This little patch is closest to the water tank, and I've already broken apart a cube 2 inches in diameter and spread it around. That's not what the instructions said to do, but I'm going to try it. And the compost is still warm. I'm getting it out of the center of the pile. If I had to guess, it's 100 degrees, 110 degrees. So I'm going to spread this bucket over the first bucket with the spawn. I'm going to put some more spawn on and then another bucket over the top until I get to that 8 inches. I have one hunk left. That's what it looks like close up. It's livening up. I can tell just by it getting wet. So this is the little bed that I made with crumbled up material. Actually, there's two kind of thicker layers, and before I put the last one on, I crumbled a few more, just to some little pieces on top. And this bed's got 5, and I threw some warmer compost on the top of it. You can see it steaming, or at least I can. That ought to liven this stuff up. And also, put a bucket of warmer material on this too. This one has 13. 13 plugs in that one. Okay. This is exciting. Now I'm going to find a spot for that last bit of plug. And I like it. Those peach pits laying on the ground have a hole in them like that. And the pit is missing. Except for I've been finding some with no holes in them. This is the area I'm picking those pits up from, and directly on top of me is this Alberta that I bought from eBay. And it's on its last legs, it's dying. Probably because I'm letting this kiwi take it over. But there's some peaches on it again this year. Yeah, you can't see it because my camera, there we go. Here it comes. Here, I see some peaches on that vine right there.
There's another seedling hazelnut. It looks like there's two of them right here. Well, this one got cut off somehow. I don't know what I did. I definitely want to take that out of here and bring it up north and transplant it. Well, there's a kiwi above, and that looks like a kiwi leaf. Here's another one that looks like a kiwi leaf. I'm gonna have to carefully dig it and see if it's a sprout from the roots, or did it come from a seed in the fruit. Either way, it's worth taking a chance on it. Leaves, it can't be a current, isn't that right? It is a different tree. It's coming. See, here's the current right here. And then this is the tree that's got the different type of leaves. I wonder if that's a cherry. I planted a Japanese cherry here a long time ago. And I just rediscovered it. It looks like the rabbits have been just eating on it every winter. So I should cage it because it looks like it's a fighter. It wants to live. So we'll give it a cage and we'll let it live.
Right above it we have a cornelian cherry that's fruiting for the first time in a big, big way. There's cherries all over it. This is the Okois variety. Came from Hungary or something. They're not that sweet, but they're okay. Best part is the birds don't like them. Those long potato eyes sticking out of the bag are flushing with leaves. Why are these zestars blushing red already? I installed this birdhouse into this chicken wire enclosure that protects berries because I also wanted it to protect the house wren babies. Predators can't get through this chicken wire to get at them. But the house wrens are small enough that chicken wire is no big deal. They actually land on it. Even the roof has got chicken wire on it. That's to protect the berries that I've planted. I also planted climbing peas in here. Some of them are doing very good, very well, growing very fast. Up we go. There's something wrong with that black walnut tree. It just doesn't want to produce any acorns. No, I'm not sure what this is. But look at it, it's got these nodules on the roots. I was thinking it's a hazelnut. See that? Bark. Do hazelnuts have nodules like that? That's interesting. There's some new plants I just dug out of the ground. Grapevine there that came from under a fontanel grist, I'm hoping. And this is a really nice, I think this is a hazelnut, but that's nice. And we have a couple of three kiwis, and they were all seedlings, none of them were root divisions. Most of these were dug out this morning. I got two carnelian cherries that came from the early fruiting tree that I have, some blackberries, walnuts, thornless blackberries. I guess there's 1, 2, 3, 4 of those. There's 1, 2, 3, 4 of the black walnuts in here, and then the two carnelian cherries. More black walnuts here. These I did the other day. I pretty much massacred it. This is doing okay. That one's really nice. This larger one is live. This one here got massacred, but I think it'll make it. These black walnuts are really tough.
Pins and needles. I've got some mushroom books, so maybe I can figure out what they are. Healthy for trees.
He's hunting because he has a hungry chick to feed. I was cleaning out this corner of the garage. It was a repository for just stuff I didn't know what to do with. I just threw it here, or I had too much of, like the bricks. And I just discovered something. I said, well, I better get a video of it, because what you're going to say is, that's just another wild permaculture story. That's what you're going to say. So I'm going to show you what I found. This was a bunch of stuff like this laying here over the top of the leaves, which are wet and dank and a very fertile spot for, guess what? This isn't soil I put here. This isn't soil put here. It just showed up from the leaves over to your ears. But this is what I'm finding. Little baby night crawlers. Well, why would that be significant? And there's earthworms in here. Why would that be significant? Because I just figured out a way that I might be able to grow worms for fishing. This is cement that had leaves on top. And look at that. Look at that. Look at all those worms. The ones with the yellow bands, that might be a crazy worm. That's okay. Fish eat those too. So now I'm going to try another experiment. I've got that tub with worms in them. I want to find out if I can grow night crawlers. This stuff had leaves over the top. I was pulling these leaves across, and there actually were just leaves under some of the wood, and there were lots of worms under that too. But not as many as this, and I thought, geez, I can't believe how many worms there are in here. This mat of leaves, I'm going to put these leaves and everything right in that worm tub. And I already got a bunch in there. I scooped some into a little container. Come on up here. If they're really tight in the hole, what you do is you relax. You let them have some of their hole back, and then they change the direction of their little fingers, and then they can come out easier. See, look at that, nice, healthy. I bet you I got 50 of them like that. Maybe more. Maybe a lot. I think this is an earthworm. Let's try earthworms in there too. Let's throw them all in there. That's what I think is a crazy worm, because it's got a yellow band to it. And they're pretty tight. I guess, oh, there's a whole bunch of, oh, they're coming right up to the crack of the, between the floor of the garage. Outside approach. There's all kinds of worms are what I'm scooping up too here.
Remember, I don't recommend this if you're sterilized. Don't be messing around with all this biology.
So here's the worm tub. I threw some in here already. You see them right here. Of course, I've been thinking I've been grabbing red wigglers the last couple of years and throwing them in here, but Brian is telling me, no, they're not red wigglers. I'm probably seeding it with earthworms, which that's okay too. We'll give it a little bit of water, and we'll see what happens. Breakfast is late this morning. I was over by the old man, and he was telling me farming stories back when they were a kid, growing cucumbers and beans. I have to tell that story, but not now. We're going to go through the list of things I'm going to eat for breakfast today. That's a parsnip leaf, my first leek, kohlrabi leaves, cilantro, mustard, radish leaf, turnip leaf, lovage, turnip leaves. These are turnips that are going to seed this year, and this is turnips that are growing for a bulb this year.
This is some type of a perennial brassica. I don't even know what it is. Fennel. Oregano. Mint. Horseradish. Thyme. Savory. Dandelion. Pea leaf. Some other brassica again, I forget. Sweet potato, mulberry leaf, grape leaves. This is white salsify with the buds. Gonna make a flower and we're gonna eat the buds. This is a garlic scape. And this is black salsify, black viper root, leaves and buds.
I didn't count how many I'm gonna have here, but that is a well-diversified diet. It's going to get my stomach bacteria just working. Get those nutrients out of all those plants. Hamburger coming from the buck I harvested last year, 2023. It's actually mixed with grazed beef as well as the heart and liver. It was all ground up together. And I'm frying it in, cooking it in a ferment, a salsa ferment. Right here it is. This is almost 2 years old. Keeps in the fridge that long and longer. I'm just discovering it now. And there's some tomatoes in here that have almond oil or avocado oil. That's from last year. There's the ferment, a salsa ferment. And then this pile of greens that I just harvested, oh my God, the aroma coming off that pile of greens is just amazing. And this is last year's elephant garlic. Some of the cloves are gummy, so I'm going to throw that in the pan. And some of the cloves are just like fresh. I crushed them because there's a special nutrient that is formed. I'm crushing them, and I'm going to eat them with olives. And then I use ground white pepper on the egg yolks. Wish you were here. I know that plants want to kill and eat me. That's why I cook them just a little bit. On top of the mixture I just showed you, they just steam. And it lessens their ability to affect me with their poisons. Here comes breakfast. This is how I decided to distribute the compost this year. Looks very interesting. I might say so myself. No doubt I'm going to be growing honey nut squash, popcorn, climbing beans, a string of climbing peas along the fence.
From the bed up to the center pole, and that's what for the climbing beans. These honey locusts have a Y at the top. It receives this center pole. I kind of missed with the screw, but it'll hold. Can't go wrong. It's got a little receiver at the other side too.
Kind of lucky that this has a bend towards the center. And you see that one has a bend, so I'm going to use that as the door gate post, and it bends over, so that this is in the center here too.
Not quite finished product. It's still hot down here in the center, but this is how I've done it every year. I started this pile May 4th and now I distributed it June 2nd. Last year was May 1st and June 1st. It might be a foot thick. Squirrels turn black.
from eating black walnuts. I'm betting this to be a wild grapevine. It's got a nice red vine to it, look at that. It's climbing up to get onto this Kentucky coffee tree.
The coffee tree is making some really nice growth. Been sitting still for 10 years. Now it's moving. Look at that black walnut pollard head. Got a huge head of hair. Must have 25, 30 of them on here.
See that water in there? That means I'm about to have mosquitoes. I saw my first couple today. And we're gonna get an inch of rain tomorrow. Isn't gonna be long, I'm gonna have to wear a mosquito suit in my backyard. Wires dented like this. Something was on top of there trying to get in. What kind of tomfoolery is this? Here we have a mound, and over there is a potato. Well, I did this on purpose. I dug a hole, and that's what created the mound, and now the potato is growing up, and I dug the potato in pretty deep. It's down there pretty deep. See the potatoes form along their stem. Not on the roots, it's on the stem. So now I'm gonna have more potatoes because I'm gonna put some of the soil up around the stem. And it may grow some more potatoes right there, right at the top where I'm covering it. So that it's peeking above the soil here, and I'll probably bring some compost in when it gets to be above again a little bit. I'll bring some compost and I'll heap it up, and then I'll finally have a hill. There. I actually dug this up when I was weeding it and reburied it, and here we have another one that survived the winter in the ground, and here's another one. A red onion that survived the winter. Now it's going to seed. There are two kiwis growing here. This front one is supposed to be the male. And the back one is supposed to be a female, Anna. And the female has gotten some bunny rabbit damage here. The male has a chicken wire around it. But I traced it up with my eyes here, and the male is the first year it's gonna blossom. We'll find out. It's a male.
Had a tube around this contender peach and voles got in it. And girdled it pretty good. Now I don't know if, you know, it was done last year or 2 years ago or 3 years ago, but for a long time it just, this tree just languished. It grew a few peaches, some leaves, that's it. It's doing the same thing this year.
Right behind that plum tree. See if I can get a better angle over here. There. You see the peach leaf curl? See, there's some peaches growing on it and new leaves. Just barely making a living.
If the peach dies this year, then I know it was the last winter girdle. The only way I want to use the tubes in the future now is I don't want to make them a fixed diameter. I want to leave them loose around the tree, and that way I can tie a string around them and make them tight right against the trunk. And then every spring I can loosen it up, and every fall I can tighten it back up and try to get it down towards the ground level. And another thing I'm going to start doing is planting daffodils right around the trunk of these trees that I know the voles will girdle. Because voles aren't supposed to like daffodils. And we're going to test that theory too.
When these kohlrabi get to be baseball size, hardball size, I'm going to start harvesting. Black locust branches, I'm going to look for thorns and I'm going to knock them off with this knife. There's a hole in this elderberry cane, and that's what was inside the cane. Isn't that interesting? I'm sure it's nothing good. I'm gonna kill it, then I'll look it up. I poured these beans out on this little plain field and I chose the fattest ones for planting. And the white stuff is diatomaceous earth because I've had even flies squeeze in underneath that seal and lay eggs in the beans. The trellis that I built, there's 8 strings on each side. Multiple seeds planted at each string. The 3 farthest away, or the 6 farthest away, are planted with one type, and then the 5 in front of it, all the way to these 2, are my favorite ones that are prolific as all anything. And I rooted, or I'm using elderberry stakes in the center here to find out if they'll root, and I think they will. So hopefully we can get some elderberries rooting in this compost because it's all fully hydrated. And I went and cut a couple of mulberry stakes to find out if I can get them to root. This is a black one on one side and a purple one on the other. You see, I left that on there. There's some berries on it yet. And then a lot of these green elderberries, they were just too floppy to use as a stake. So I just stuck them in there, see if they'll root. The farthest away 4, 2 on each side, are black locust stakes, and that's what I was originally gonna do this whole thing with. After I put those 2 in, I was got to thinking, well, let's see if we can get elderberries to root in here. Use them as a stake at the same time. And the old permaculture thing about multiple functions. So this enclosure here that I'm building is going to be growing multiple crops. Already I planted climbing peas on the edge all the way around. They'll climb up that fence. And then the rows are going to be for popcorn. I got black popcorn that's being delivered tomorrow. I eat popcorn. So let's try popcorn. And then of course we're going to have the climbing beans and the rooting elderberries. And I've got some ends here that don't have anything on yet. And we'll have to figure out what to do with that. I think we're gonna have a few plums this year.
just goes on. This is a European plum that was in the yard when we purchased the property in 1984. And this is like its fourth iteration. It springs up someplace in the yard here, and then the big one dies. The sun's been scraping off the black knot, so now they're living longer. The original plum tree was here. And then there's been like one or two that have come and gone already, besides the original one. Then that was the longest one, the oldest one that's now existing. It's got a pretty big trunk on the bottom, but we've been cutting it down as it gets black knot. Normally they just die off before they get that old, but because we're cutting the black knot off, they're lasting longer. And then here's the new one. This is a brand new one that just shot up a year or so ago. Suckers are good. Black popcorn seed came in the mail today, this 4th of June. Now I'm gonna plant it up straight up into the compost that I made this year, 2024. And as the corn grows, it's gonna send out secondary shoots above the root ball, and I'm gonna cover those with compost and it'll actually grow roots. So we'll have double root systems. Double trouble. I didn't plant it this way, but it ended up 55 seeds on each side. You can see the little dimples. Every one of those little holes represents a black popcorn seed. And we got more rain coming, and already the compost is fully hydrated. I expect all these seeds that I planted today to just pop. Just because I think that doesn't mean the seeds think that, so we'll see. Oh, I was talking about that European plum yesterday, and here's one of the old ones right here. That's how big they get before the black knot takes them. Having stored European plums in the freezer and eating them, now in the spring, I have the pits to plant. I saw a chipmunk. I'm getting out all my rat trap equipment. We're going to trap that chipmunk before he starts eating all my stuff. Fleabing. Cup plant. See, it has a cup. And the cup holds water. So the insects and the birds can get a drink. Nice looking cup plant. Pure compost made 2023. Right here in my backyard. And then here's a bed of a compost mix where I've been adding a lot of compost to it. See that? Looks so nice. And then here is soil that I took out from in front of the shed where I didn't add very much compost. You can see the differences. Still good looking soil. I mean, you can see some sand in it, a little bit of clay. That's the differences. Compost. Garden bed with a lot of compost having been added over the years. And the soil that was here. Over $70 for this 50-foot roll of chicken wire, 7 foot tall, 1-inch mesh. Economical, it says economical. Fucking lying bastards. The chicken wire is slated to be installed around this little garden here that I produced from the 2024 compost. Lots of seeds already been planted, but the chicken wire is to keep the woodchucks out.
And because I'm also gonna probably put chicken wire over the top. I got that center post, no big deal. Well, look at that rain last night, tightened up all these jute strings. Ooh, yeah, they're tight. Look at that. You can always loosen them up a little bit or slide them up the stakes. Sweet potato experiment in this 20-gallon tree pot. There's a mixture of my compost and garden bed soil that's been treated with compost and just soil with no compost. It's all mixed up in there. The very top layer is just 100% compost because that, as it rains, will work down in. And I was careful to spread the roots out so they fanned out as much as they could. Some of them didn't have very many roots, but like this one. Now this one here had really long roots and it's all the way over here. So we're hoping that it makes a lot of potatoes. We'll see. I don't know. Never tried this before. I'm definitely going to be harvesting leaves for eating. It's propped up on this pile of very rough compost from this year. That's the rough stuff that came out of right here. And you can see there's still lots of rough stuff in there, but this was rough of the rough. And it's kind of wobbly. So I got to kind of keep an eye on it that it shifts one way or the other, but I kind of like that idea because a woodchuck comes up, he's going to put his paws on there and it's going to give a little bit. He might not want to crawl up in there. Another experiment. I don't want to be in this game of what is the prettiest. What I want is the most productive. However, I can have both. A warm front has arrived, and more rain coming tomorrow ought to kickstart this growing area off in a big way. Black walnut seedlings that were planted by squirrels in my backyard, and now I've been digging them up, put them in these little pots. I think I'll offer them for sale on Craigslist. I've got some thornless blackberries that I've been taking out. Although this one doesn't look that great. We'll see what happens. A couple of carnelian cherries that came up from seed that I just planted in the ground. I did want to show you this phenomenon, this bucket of compost that I had put together for these black walnuts. These are larger. You know, they're like 2-3 year olders. And the rain filled the bucket up and they're still living. I gotta think about what I need to do here. I'm walking around the backyard and looking at the different plants. I have these ideas and I thought, oh, I gotta try that someday. And then I just keep walking. Well, this is one of the ideas. I already did one of them here. I just want to kind of bend those potato plants over a little bit. Get more of the stem underground. Because that's where the potatoes spring from, the stem. Maybe I'll get one or two extra potatoes here. This one's already got a natural bend to it. Look at that. Yeah. Have to trim off some of this comfrey so that they can get some sun. That's what comfreys are for. Really shouldn't eat them. Yeah, one more here. Looks like it kind of wants to bend over that way. Well, let's bend it this way. All right, so that's an idea. See what happens. The machine I use to cut the lucerne. The blade would slice through the stem.
is simple. How simple life is. This is the cut lucerne. I'm gonna gather up as much with my hands as I can, bring it home for mulch. Maybe I'll process it in a ferment tank. You can see I left the strip of it here. There's some milkweed mixed in. On the other side of that, there's a big patch of milkweed up there. I didn't cut that. There's a few of them that were scattered in the lucerne. But I didn't see them until all of a sudden, no, I just cut one. There's probably half a dozen of them in there. Now let's see how much I get. This area here I just gathered by hand. It's maybe 3-4 foot wide and maybe 15 foot long. That's the amount I got. That might be enough to feed a goat for a day in winter. So it took me maybe 2 minutes to do that. So how many minutes, how many days is it going to take to gather enough of this material by hand to feed a goat? 4 armloads. I just remembered I got one of those really big wide rakes. I think that'll gather this up really nice. I'm going to go home and get it, try it out. Not adhering to the permaculture rule of thinking for 100 minutes for every minute of work, I went back and I got the rake. If I was thinking, I would have brought the rake with me when I went to cut this stuff. But I really want to do an experiment with this rake to see if it works. Yeah, I do. Big wide fork. I also see Joe Pye weed and goldenrod and canary grass. Tansy. Milkweed, lots of nutrients in this stuff. The last fork that I'm going to take. Not even close to being 100% efficient. Maybe like 70, but 30% of it goes back to the land. Fodder for the land. The land will last longer. I know the owner of this, I rent from him, and he's interested in making money. So he'll probably flatten all this stuff out and use it for some type of a parking lot. But not today. I got my use out of it today. I'm following the trail of lucerne. Heads off, turns to the right. You can see the trail all the way through into my food forest area. So here I am taking another 90 degree turn to the right, to right here. Look at that. I didn't realize there's that much. So I'm gonna be stuffing this into a barrel. I don't know, think so. Probably gonna be 2 barrels. But then one of my employees came out here, older, much older fella. Has a lot of experience. He said, oh, he says, that is a broad fork. He says, that's what the Amish use. Well, I didn't want to get into a discussion about the Amish with him. The Amish are using machines around here now. But sure was fun. Now, I mentioned the goat before. How much, you know, how long would that feed a goat, that pile there? But what's even more important is this is some of the most nutritious fodder that can be had. So if a farmer mixed this, or a homesteader mixed this with some lower quality fodder, you know, it might be a couple months this would last. You'd upgrade that lower quality fodder. Wants to fall over. Oh, that'll get a million views. Having drawn this barrel down about 3/4, I now filled it back up with rainwater. Especially this last batch that I used just now, I didn't stir it up, so the best material is on the bottom, the best concentration. What we did was dilute that concentrated bottom of the barrel mixture with rainwater.
This now has become my wiggler worm trap. The wigglers, they hatch and they migrate out of these little holes, get onto the wood, and they crawl underneath the pot. Now you can see there's some here. I've already flicked off a whole lot of them into my worm tub. So I'm gonna go flick these in too before I set this back. So I don't know what those are. Maybe they eat worms. That's how much water that I had drawn out of that ferment barrel to fertilize the garden beds. Now, I'm gonna fit as much as this lucerne into that barrel as I possibly can. All right, I got a good base built up here in the barrel. And I fished out the fish heads from the freezer. From, I don't know, 2 weeks ago we went fishing for jack salmon, coho salmon. Material and water, an enhanced fish hydrolysis. And that's what was in that barrel I'm drawing down and fertilizing the garden beds with. It's just similar to this. Instead of lucerne, it was comfrey. These are black walnut husks. I should have grabbed them before and got them in here a little deeper. We'll make a nest. I've dumped out a whole barrel of black walnuts. And the squirrels have been cleaning the nuts out. Here's one here they missed. And another one. Oh, that's a shell. I think they've been taking them and eating the kernel. That's a nut. There's iodine in these husks. I like to put those in these barrels too. Okay. I had to grab the bucket, and then I thought, well, I'll throw some of those husks in there. All right, now I got a barrel here with water in it. I'm gonna fill this up. Also have this thing right here. That's 270, well probably 260 gallons now. I've been using a little bit of it here and there of water. Rainwater. Cool, clear, free rainwater. This has been a nice project today. Something I haven't done before, which makes it highly interesting to find out what's going to happen. So here we got water right to the top. Water right to the top. So last year, there's some pawpaw seeds in there. I don't know how those got in there. But last year I'd fill this water right to the top, right before everything froze up in winter. That's what it did to the top. It was actually a lot worse than that. It was sticking up like 4 inches. When it thawed out, it relaxed a little bit. Now I don't have a really good fitting cover here. It's okay, but it's not like it was. Okay. Doesn't stay in the hands as bad when it's fermented for a winter. Oh, look at that, Brian. It's got a yellow tail. It's got to be a little red wiggler. Come on. Get over here so you can see that tail of yours. Lots of food in here.
Look at him. He's really going in fast. Oh, there he goes again. There's his yellow tail. Sure enough, just like Brian says, have fun. There's another 12 or 15 of them. Yeah, they had yellow tails. That one there, I kind of squished a little bit. Look at that yellow tail on him, huh?
Black popcorn that I planted in the backyard. Now I'm going to find out what kind of popcorn it makes in this popcorn bopper. It's got big kernels. That's what one thing I liked. I like using this popcorn bopper because it's fast. I'm imagining the lowest amount of energy. Well, that's how I roll. I plant it, and then I want to figure out, well, what did I plant? It's okay. It's heavier stuff because it doesn't just come blowing out of the popcorn popper. Mmm. Not too bad, actually. Maybe this one will work out. Warm sun beating down on the beds that I planted with the seeds. I'm expecting seeds to pop right out of the ground. Oh, look! There's a pea. That just popped right out of the ground. Just look at these climbing peas. They were never taught to climb up a fence. You gotta be helped. Oh, I gotta help them. If I want good, healthy peas, that's what I have to do. Come on over this way. Just listen to me and come over this way. You're gonna like it better. I don't know if it's gonna keep that hold or not, but that's how I'm gonna go with it for now. Can always come back later. She doesn't like I'm by her nest. I heard some squeaking. This tree is full of little tiny pawpaws like this, and I'm waiting for a lot of them to be aborted. Just like that. There's just too many. It'd be just crazy. Most of these hang on. This tree is just loaded. Black raspberries are buzzing. Ooh, what's that? I don't know what that fly is. There's another one. There's another one. It's got a black abdomen. Look at that. Is that a fly or some type of a bee? Bunch of these little bitty ones all over the place. Big bumblebees in here. I mean, this whole thing is buzzing. Black raspberries for the pollinators. And then for me.
not gonna be ripe, but I'm gonna eat one anyways. Because I can.
Ooh, that's dark. This is an experiment blackberry primal cane that's blossoming profusely this year. I've got berries off it in the past. They haven't been very big and they're not sweet. We got a number of canes here and they're going to her. I don't really need sweet ones. Interesting blossom. There's little blossom buds are all around it. So presumably this little cluster is gonna have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 berries. The promise of elderberries.
Those be apricots. Tree has a lots of them this year. It's just nuts. This is all from one cane. Oh, I'm so looking forward to this. Give it to me, baby.
New growth on this mulberry. Just amazing. One after the other. Look at that. All brand new growth. Plus, we're going to get to taste the berries, see what they're like. A graft that is bent over with weight from the new growth. And that's okay, I'm not going to stake it. Because maybe this one here will become the new lead. I grow up. Not a problem. You see the graft here. I've shown it before. Doesn't look that great. But putting a little weight on it now, it's going to have to callus up. We'll see. So I'm debating whether I want to just grow to sticks because of more firewood, or if I want to produce a nice ball here at the top of the pollard. Oh look, I discovered a nice place to hold my coffee cup. A male mulberry that looks like it's suffering some type of a dieback. Got new growth going out of the tops. We have an infestation of slugs in here. I guess I'm gonna have to do something.